Hi everyone. One of the questions I get asked the most on my travels is, what was it really like to play in YBS? So it got me thinking, what a perfect opportunity during lockdown to get some of my old buddies and colleagues together to have a bit of a chat and a reminisce about the old days. This first video features those players telling all about what it was like for them to play in the band and what made it so special for them too. I hope you enjoy watching this video as much as we all did reminiscing and taking a trip down memory lane. And here are the players introducing themselves.
I'm Peter Roberts. I played soprano cornet in YBS Band from November 1997 until November 2004.
My name's Gavin Saynor. I did two stints with YBS, the first from October 96 to the summer of 98, and then I went back as solo E flat bass from October 2002 up until March 2005, but then returned for the Australia tour.
I'm Terry Griffiths. I played Second Man Down in the band from January 2004 to about July, August 2006.
I'm Mike Walsh. I joined the band after the Nationals in 1995. On euphonium at that stage. That didn't last very long. Then I went on baritone, second baritone after that. Flitted around a bit, but mainly second baritone for the period. I'm still in the band in its current guise of Hammonds. So I've been in the band in one guise or another for 25 years.
Okay, my name is Morgan Griffiths. I was a principal euphonium with the band in two spells actually. First from 1992 to 2002, and then from 2004 to 2005.
My name's Dave Clegg. I played second horn at YBS from 1993 till 2002, and then I came back for a shorter spell in 2006. I was originally in the band, it was Hammond Source Works when I first joined with Morgan and Gary. And that was conducted by Jeff Whitten. And shortly after that, we lost the sponsorship, and obviously the new sponsorship came into being a few months after, which was YBS.
Hi, I'm Ben Godfrey, and I was principal cornet between 1994 and 1996. And then I returned as a guest principal between 1999 and 2001, and later intermittently came back playing in competitions and concerts between 2002 and 2003.
I am Gavin Pritchard. I was percussionist with the band, started in January of 1997 with the Masters. Went to another band for 6 months and came back again, and then stayed with YBS until I think it was the start of 2005.
I'm Marley Antrobus, and I was first baritone at YBS from autumn 97 and summer 2002.
My name is Glenn Allen. I played trombone until 2003.
My name is Darren West. I'm a B-flat bass player with the band. I joined in July 1995. And like Mike, this is my 25th year with the band as we are now as Hammonds.
So I'm Sheona White / Wade, whichever one you want to call me. And I played solo horn in the band from, I've forgotten again, 1995 till 2006. Why do you think YBS was so successful, and what made it tick? Peter.
Yeah, well, I think the reason why it was so successful is it had a set of soloists that were unprecedented in banding that's ever been. And also it had the secondary players who were stand-up soloists in their own right, and allied to that, we had a fantastic band trainer in David, who moulded us all together, and I thought we were like more of a family than a band, and we all pulled for one another, and we were all there for one another. and I'm getting a bit emotional now, but you know, but you know, we were there for everybody, for all the band, you know, and I thought that was what made the success that it was.
Yeah, absolutely. That's absolutely brilliant. That's perfect. Anyone else want to add to that their own? Cleggy?
Yeah, I obviously agree with what Peter said. But obviously the main thing is Dave King. We had the best conductor that was available, and he still is the best. We had a great sponsorship, which gave Dave the space and the time to build a band, which that doesn't always happen these days. And also one thing, not to get into politics or anything, but he was in charge of the band. Nobody could question what he said. And I think that was very important as well. So he had the time and space to make the band his own, in his own image, if you like. And I think also we had some really stalwart people in backroom staff, Ted Griffiths and Paul Land and Richard Hurst. And all those things put together, obviously the soloists that Pete just mentioned, they were just out of this world. Incredible.
Yeah, I think I know from my own experience, having played in other top bands since then, for me, it's I never ever, I don't actually think that I realised what it was at the time. I definitely didn't realise what it was at the time. And I have never ever played in anything even remotely like that ever since. And we never will. And I think that's why it's so special. But just to have, I never ever thought that anyone was going to mess up or anything like that. You just knew everybody was just always going to play. Even though you did think probably yourself, oh, I might mess this up, or you were like totally feeling like that yourself, but no one else in the band ever thought you were going to mess up. And having played in other bands, that's not always the case. I've never felt like that anywhere else. And it's that security. Even though you weren't sort of really cocky and thought you were brilliant or thought you were going to do it, you still doubted yourself a bit, but everyone else just knew you were going to play. Okay, anyone else? Gav, you had your hand up. Big Gav.
Well, I've got the three things that Peter's put down. You know, I don't like the term secondary players. You know, they were as important as the soloists, and, you know, people like Cleggy on second horn and, you know, Mike on baritone, they were as good, you know. And putting all that together, just everybody just played their own piece, their own piece of the jigsaw, if you like. But I've got additional here is we have that singular sort of musicality, you know. I've never played in a band where we sort of feel the same, we're moving on the same journey together, you know. The musical lines, the nuances, like Peter said, and Cleggy said, Kingy was part of that, obviously, driving us forward. But we all felt it, you know. I've never felt a band do a rubato like we used to do, for example, you know. So in a musical sense, it was just as one, as it should be, as a good band should be, you know.
Yeah, that's perfect. Thank you, Simon.
I have to say, I mean, I was only there for a short time, 3 years, I think, if that. But there was a real freshness to it. When I was in the band, from everyone that was in the band when I was there, there was also that element of when you walked into every rehearsal, there was such an atmosphere of focus and such hard graft as well. There was not one minute that passed in all of those rehearsals where you felt like it was a waste of time. It was phenomenal, I thought. The rehearsal technique from Dave, and also just the amount of focus from the players was, I've never experienced that since YBS.
No, me neither. Okay. Other Gav, you wanted to say something.
Yeah. It was that, like Big Gav said, about the singular idea that we're all on the same page at all times. Again, like you said, Sheona, I've not seen that since in all the bands I've played with. It's just not happened. And it's something I didn't recognize at the time. It was that's the way we did it. It was natural, and I think it comes from the leadership we had and the fact that we all did the same thing together at the same level. And I think that's the next important thing, is like Simon was alluding to there. There was an atmosphere where we all tried for our very best at all times. There was no lull. We weren't working up towards anything. We were just there all the time. And then when the contest came around, we were just ready to go. What piece were we playing this time? We were already playing our best. And that again, that's something unique. I've never experienced that since. Played in some good bands where we've done, playing good performances, but we've worked up to that moment. And it just seems to coincide with that contest and therefore the band won. Whereas with us, we were just there all the time. We were consistent. The concert, contest, rehearsal didn't matter. We played our best all the time. And that's what I find unique about this.
Yeah, it is. And I remember like just sometimes being quite nervous just going to a few rehearsals and things because I had to. It wasn't a case of like, it was never any different really going on the contest stage as it was going to rehearsal because those expectations from Dave were just so high for us all the time. But we wanted that. It wasn't a case of you didn't want that. Everyone just had the same, they believed in his ethos, they believed in everything that he was doing and they loved it. So you genuinely wanted to do brilliantly. Anyone else want to add their thoughts to that one? Margie?
I thought the blend of the sound that we had at the middle of the band is quite unique to anything I've ever played with either before or after, and it's just the way that Dave used to put the layers in there, and you were never kind of obsolete, just sat there not meaning anything. All the parts were important, and even though it was like euphonium baritone playing or horns baritones whatever, you were always there and important, and you wanted to hear that sound, and that blend comes through in everything you hear us play. And you can really hear the difference in bands that don't have that kind of presence in the middle.
Yeah, and they don't understand it. They don't understand it. And it was a very unique thing that we learned to do. And again, myself playing in other bands since, even though I know how to do it, and I'm playing with bands that Dave conducts, it's still not, it's because everybody felt it, everybody did it, and everybody understood that the sound came from the middle of the band, and everyone else had to kind of adjust around that. I think that's probably one of the reasons I absolutely loved playing in Dave's bands, because I was just really important for my own ego. You just felt so good because it was you, the horn and the baritone and euphoniums and flugel were just the absolute most important thing for him in the sound concept. Excuse me. Morgan?
Yeah, well, I mean, really echoing what everyone else said, but it was just a very special time, wasn't it? I mean, the band itself. I mean, for a lot of reasons, not just for one. I mean, it had every element together, I think, at the same time. I mean, we're all great mates for a start. So, yeah, and all the rehearsals were brilliant. I mean, you never not enjoyed coming. I mean, it was just a pleasure to turn up. You just love coming, you know. So it was a joy playing. I mean, the band was fantastic. So around the stand, everyone thought the same. The musicality from everyone was exactly the same, which, again, was through Dave, but everyone else as well, you know. And so just a pleasure, wasn't it, to play? And I mean, it wasn't just the soloists either. It was all the band as a whole. And everyone were great friends as well. That's the other thing. It was just a great time to be there, wasn't it?
Oh, brilliant. Mike?
I think there's a misconception that there were a lot of players that played. There was a kind of throughput of players, because in one way there was, because if you look back, you can probably name 100 Cornet players and so on, and that's right. Mm-hmm. But actually, there was a core of the band for a time, maybe 15 to 20 players, who over a period of 7 or 8 years were all in the band together. Yes, the others rotated. A lot of the others did rotate because a lot of people didn't last very long because either they didn't subscribe to the ethos or they didn't like it and they didn't fit in or whatever. But actually, there was a consistent core, and I think that's lost when some people say they played for YBS because they did one contest or one concert or so on. So there's that consistency of players, which everything else that's been said is right, because, of course, that consistency breeds the way that you play and the style that everyone plays, but also the consistency with the conductor. It wasn't just Dave King was there. He was there virtually all the time. Yes, there were perhaps 2 or 3 concerts a year when someone else might conduct, but not generally. So he was there all the time, instilling the ethos of how you play and the standard all the time. So there's a kind of double consistency there, consistency of the conductor and consistency of the players around the stand as well, which is always important.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely brilliant. Does anyone else want to add anything? That's just perfect. Ben?
Yeah, I just agree with everything that's been said. I think it's important to say that the young players there was a great nucleus of Salford players from Salford College in those days. And what a training ground that was. All of that talent and enthusiasm came across into YBS, and that mixed with the more senior players. So you had Morgan and later Peter and just a lot of different players like that, you know, who put them together and they stayed together for a number of years. With that enthusiasm, I think Dave, he was able to shape and drive them as hard as he could, and they could take it because those players were so loyal. And, you know, they could, a lot of players couldn't take that sort of almost punishment, you know, being pushed harder and harder to play, perform better and better. And yet, I think that was part of the secret, the fact put those players together, they could take as much as Dave threw at them, and they just got better and better. And with his ability, you know, what he could bring out of the score, his energy and technique as a conductor, absolutely unprecedented. So it was, what a powerful combination it was.
Yeah, that's brilliant, Ben. And you think about all the players that, even, you know, the ones that are here, and then there's some others as well that we couldn't have because it's just impossible to have so many people, but they've all gone on to be the best at what they do and at the top of their field. And we'll get to that at the end of today, what you're all doing now. I mean, you, everyone has just had the most incredible experiences and careers because of being part of that. And you said being at the university, you know, we had at least 4 hours a week band rehearsal being trained by Dave at band. Our lessons, they were like 4 hours long every week. They, you know, we were just surrounded and saturated by that ethos. And then we would go to band at YBS, and then you would just extend that, and you know, you'd be playing for like 6 hours a day sometimes. You just loved it. It was just everything you wanted to do. And I never felt that I was being pressurized into performing. The only pressure I put on myself was the pressure myself. And you know, you talk back to people not being able to handle that, and I think he found the people who could handle that, and that's because you wanted to choose that yourself. You wanted to be the best you could be, and then that's how we as a group probably have ended up continuing that and being really successful. But you know, a lot of people from the outside looked in and thought, oh, they must have been like really scary and terrifying, and you know, how did they even manage to play? And actually, for me, honestly, it was the complete opposite. That's where I felt safe, actually, and the safest place for me to play was in that, because that was what I knew. But it's funny how from the outside in it looked kind of the complete opposite.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So there we have it, a small insight into what it really felt like to play in YBS Band. Join me next time, where we will continue down our journey and look a little bit more closely at what it really felt like to walk onto a contest stage with this phenomenal band.